Good morning and welcome to worship this morning. We're excited that you're here to worship along with us and invite you to participate in today's service. If you have spiritual care or physical care needs that we or the elders can help meet, I ask you to contact us at the numbers below. We'd love to be able to do our best to provide for you during this time. Another thing that has changed for us is how we donate our tithes and offerings, and we've in the past provided a few options for you, and I have one more for you today. As always, you can drop off your offering here at the church at any time throughout the week. We are often here. If you text us again, we can make sure that we're here before you drive out. You can use the Give button on our website, although there is a small fee for us using that. You are welcome to use that. You can mail your offering to us at the address of the church. And this week, we've added that you can email your offering to us as well. And so if you're interested in giving in that way, you would send an e-transfer to office@fbchurch.ca. And we just ask that you put in the memo column the name and address of the person that we are to receipt it to, if that's your desire. Finally, I would like to remind you that there are KidSpot videos up as well, and so sometime after this service or throughout your week, take advantage of that teaching from Carla and enjoy some teaching for your kids, specifically aimed at both elementary and grade 5 and 6 groups. Let's worship God this morning together. I invite you to join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, God, we do thank you for today. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that it brings to honor you, to praise you, and to serve you. We pray, Lord, that you engage with us today as well, and that we would hear from you, that we would be blessed by your presence, and that we'd be moved and changed because of our relationship with you. In your name we pray. Amen. As we enter into our time of worship, let's focus our hearts on God the Father. God of perfect and perfecting love, we say that we love you, but far too often we abide in our own selfish and narrow desires, and your word does not become flesh in the way we live in the world. We say that we love our neighbor, but too often that means only those neighbors that we believe are worthy of our love. We claim to be your people, but we trade discipleship for mere religion. Forgive us, Lord, and spare not your love from us. Come and fill our hearts with your love. Come and refine us and make us new. Cast out our fear and perfect us in love, that we might worship and serve you in newness of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let's worship God the Father.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope and you restore every heart that is broken.
Sing it to him.
Great are you, Lord, 'cause it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out praise to you only.
You give life, sing it out.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. Pour out our praise, it's your breath.
praise to you only.
See a bicycle in the church sanctuary, but I've got one in here today, and I am going to attempt to ride the bicycle around all the chairs and try to not wipe out or hit anything. So let's see how I do. All right. I didn't do too bad, but let's try and make things a little bit more challenging. I'm going to call on my personal assistant, Maddie, and she's going to bring me this blindfold, and I'm going to blindfold myself now so that I can't see anything. Go ahead, Maddie. Don't get the tape in all my hair. Ha, that's supposed to be a joke. Okay, that's good. That's very tight. Okay. Now, just to make it a little bit more challenging, I'm going to try riding the bike on the same path through the aisles without hitting anything, but I literally cannot see anything. It's black, just dark. So, I'm going to give this a try and let's see how it goes. Oh, hit a chair there. Now I'm... All right, so, wow, apparently, oh, who's going to straighten out all these chairs? Good thing Maddie is here. First of all, let me say this. Don't try this at home, and definitely don't try this in the church sanctuary. You know, riding a bicycle in the sanctuary is actually kind of fun, and it's not too hard. Riding a bicycle blindfolded in the church sanctuary is very difficult. You know, riding this bike blindfolded is a little bit like our lives. We don't always know what's ahead of us or what the future holds. That's why God gives us things like parents and teachers and pastors and friends and others to help guide us through life. Even more importantly, God gives us His Word, the Bible, and His Holy Spirit to help guide us. In just a moment, a screen will appear with some Bible references. When it appears, pause the video and then take some time to look up the verses and read them out loud. Maybe if there's more than one of you there, you can take turns looking up the verses and reading them. Then discuss what the verse says about how God guides us.
I want to continue today with you our study of 1 Kings. And so if you have a Bible with you, or if you have one nearby, grab it and flip to the book of 1 Kings. We're in chapter 11 today. We started chapter 11 last week, and we'll do a brief recap of what we talked about last week and then continue on. So last week we saw and talked about and discussed that Solomon had rejected the covenant that God had made with the kings of Israel. He had pursued personal wealth over and above other things. He had built a large army made up of horses that he recruited even from their old enemy, from Egypt. He was relying on his own power instead of on God's protection and provision. He pursued women and wives. He chased physical gratification. And worst of all, he worshipped false gods. 1 Kings 11, verse 7 to 8 says this, "On a hill east of Jerusalem, Solomon built a high place for Chemosh, the detestable god of Moab, and for Molech, the detestable god of the Ammonites. He did the same for all his foreign wives, who burned incense and offered sacrifices to their gods." Today we want to talk about what the results of that were in the life of Solomon. It begins in verse 9, where it describes God's response to what Solomon has done. It says, "The Lord became angry with Solomon because his heart had turned away from God, the God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice." Now, later on, we're going to talk about this idea that God became angry with Solomon. It's not one that's very popular for Christians today, but I think it's an idea that we need to explore a little bit together. But in this verse, it has this phrase that the Lord had even appeared to him twice. And I want to explore this a little bit with us, because It again seems a little unusual that someone who has seen the Lord twice, who has had a physical appearance of God before him, or at least in some ways has engaged with God directly, would turn from him, would worship other gods. And as much as our minds may struggle with that, perhaps if we look at our own lives, if we look at how we behave and how we act, that response may seem slightly less unreal. I mean, we're probably not physically building temples to false gods. We're probably not erecting high places in our home to worship idols. And yet at the same time, often in the lives of Christians today, we see that their life doesn't reflect the experience of Jesus that they've had. Far too many people have an experience of God. They see Jesus, they come to terms with him, they accept him as Lord and Savior, and then they continue in life in a way that denies the encounter they've had. And Solomon was no different. He experienced the Lord twice, and God holds this in his account of him, that he had appeared to Solomon twice, and yet he still turned his back on him. In verse 14, we see more of the results of Solomon's disobedience. It says, "Then the Lord raised up against Solomon an adversary, Hadad the Edomite, from the royal line of Edom." And down in verse 23, "And God raised up against Solomon another adversary, Razon, son of Eliada." In verse 24, we see that Razon took over Damascus, and in verse 25, that he rules from Aram, which is Damascus, or present-day Syria. Now, sometimes Christians want to act like God only judges in eternity. That the only part in judgment that God has is to wait until we die and then to place us under judgment as to whether we go to heaven or to hell. Unfortunately, this isn't the witness of Scripture. God can bring judgment on sinful rebellion in this world too. And I use the word can bring because most often he offers grace upon grace upon grace to those that love him, to those that serve him, but foolishly rebel against him in their lives. He offers grace more often than not. But this text reminds us that it is within his right to bring judgment. And I believe that he still behaves in that way today. Often we talk about the difference that the death, resurrection, and life of Jesus brought about, and it changed nearly everything. So it's right for us to remember that. But what it didn't change is the character of God. And so even in some of these Old Testament passages that we understandably want to dismiss, we can see that God's character is intact. Now perhaps God doesn't deal with nations the same way. His chosen people are no longer an ethnic group, but selected from throughout humanity. There are certainly things that have changed about how God interacts with us because of what Jesus did. And yet the character of God is the same. His right to judge us, his holiness, our sinfulness, these things have remained constant. Now last week in speaking about COVID, I feel I misspoke slightly. I used the phrase, God is shaking the world today. Now more than one of you followed up with me, which I'm thankful for. It allows me to be a little clearer about how I'm thinking about these things this week. What I was trying to say at the time is that I believe that God is using this crisis to display that many of the things in which people have inappropriately put their trust are temporary and are meaningless in the light of eternity. But I certainly overspoke. That wasn't in my notes. Because when I said God is shaking the world, it could be understood that what I was saying, and easily understood what I was saying, is that I believe God to be the causative agent of this pandemic. And I don't think that's the case. I haven't been told that clearly from God, and I don't see that in what's going on around me. I don't think that's what it is. More often than not, I feel like these things are a result of our own sinful rebellion against God. God created a perfect world that was meant to be free of sickness and death. And because of sin, because of what humanity did, that was broken. And all of this evil came out of that. Out of our own rebellion against God. And I suspect that's what this pandemic is. But even from this story, we see that there are results to our sin in the here and now. That it's not just that ancient sin in the garden that brings about results, but our sin in our lives today bring about results in our lives. And so we see in the life of Solomon here that he rebels against God, that he sets up false idols, that he does all these things that are detestable to God, and that there are real life consequences for him. That God raises up two men to keep him hemmed in at his borders. Israel exists kind of at this crossroads of nations. It has Egypt to the south and powers to the north and powers to the east as well. And they all at times have controlled Israel, either militarily or by instilling them as a vassal state. And so in the midst of this, God keeps Solomon's empire in check by putting an enemy to the north and an enemy to the south so that he's always on edge. And he does something else. His judgment isn't even complete in that. And we see this in the last part of the text that we're looking at today. So in chapter 11, verse 26, we'll read to the end of the chapter now. Also, Jeroboam, son of Nebat, rebelled against the king. He was one of Solomon's officials, an Ephraimite from Zereda, and his mother was a widow named Zeruiah. Here is the account of how he rebelled against the king. Solomon had built the terraces and had filled in the gap in the wall of the city of David, his father. Now Jeroboam was a man of standing, and when Solomon saw how well the young man did his work, he put him in charge of the whole labor force of the tribes of Joseph. About that time, Jeroboam was going out of Jerusalem, and Ahijah, the prophet of Shiloh, met him on the way, wearing a new cloak. The two of them were alone out in the country, and Ahijah took hold of the new cloak he was wearing and tore it into 12 pieces. Then he said to Jeroboam, "Take 10 pieces for yourself. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. See, I am going to tear the kingdom out of Solomon's hand and give you 10 tribes. But for the sake of my servant David and the city of Jerusalem, which I have chosen out of all the tribes of Israel, he will have one tribe. I will do this because they have forsaken me and worshipped Ashtaroth, the goddess of the Sidonians, Chemosh, the god of the Moabites, and Molech, the god of the Ammonites, and have not walked in obedience to me, nor done what is right in my eyes, nor kept my decrees and laws as David, Solomon's father, did. But I will not take the whole kingdom out of Solomon's hand. I have made him ruler all the days of his life for the sake of David, my servant, whom I chose and who obeyed my commands and decrees. I will take the kingdom from his son's hands and give you 10 tribes. I will give one tribe to his son so that David, my servant, may always have a lamp before me in Jerusalem, the city where I chose to put my name. However, as for you, I will take you and you will rule over all that your heart desires and you will be king over Israel. If you do whatever I command you and walk in obedience to me and do what is right in my eyes by obeying my decrees and commands, as David, my servant, did, I will be with you. I will build you a dynasty as enduring as the one I built for David and will give Israel to you. I will humble David's descendants because of this, but not forever." Solomon tried to kill Jeroboam, but Jeroboam fled to Egypt, to Shishak, the king, and stayed there until Solomon's death. One of the things that I love about this part of the story is that even in the midst of his judgments, God's grace is so evident. This is a section where it describes what the results of Solomon's sin are, and they are severe. The kingdom will be torn from the line of his descendants. It will be reduced in size, and yet, even in the midst of this, there is so much grace. In grace, a new covenant is extended to the house of Jeroboam. So similar to that was given to David. If you walk in my ways and obey me, your descendants will rule Israel. There's a grace given to Solomon that he is allowed to complete his rule, even though he's worshipped false gods and turned his back on the true God. And God raises enemies against him, even though all of this happens. It's God's grace that he's allowed to complete his rule. In grace, God offers to Solomon's descendants the southern tribe and says, you will continue to rule this much smaller kingdom, but I will allow you to continue to rule. And there's this illusion of grace that once again out of David's line will a king arise. We know and understand that that is an allusion to Jesus, that he would be a king of David's line who would rule for all time. What I want us to be clear about today is that there are repercussions to our sins here on earth. Now, it may not always be a one-to-one correlation. It may be difficult to track sometime, but if there is unrepented sin in your life, there will be repercussions in your life for that. It's why I think it's so crucial that we spend times looking and seeking for sin within our life, coming before God and saying, God, what have I done that is sinful in your eyes? Not in my eyes, which are faulty, but in your eyes, Lord. What is wrong that is within me? What needs to be made right? And when we find that, when we locate that, our options are to continue in our rebellion or to bring it to God and say, God, your judgment of this is right, and I desire for you to fix this. We don't have the strength or the power to do that on our own. We only have the strength or the power to acknowledge what Jesus says about it and to offer it up to him. Say, Lord, my desire is to turn from this. Will you make me whole again? Will you make me right again? Will you fix that part of me that needs fixing? And will you bring about new life within me? I want you to spend some time in these moments as I'm praying, considering what that thing is in your life that needs to be brought before the throne of Christ. That thing that you've been concealing or hiding. That thing that maybe you know about and others know about, but you're still not ready to give up. Let's bring that to the throne of grace. Let's make sure that that's not left in the dark, but is brought into the light, that Christ can bring wholeness to that again. And let's truly be repentant of that, not turning to our old ways, but turning to Christ whenever our hearts lean in that direction. Join me in prayer together. Heavenly Father, God, Lord, we're so thankful that you saved us. And God, that is a complete and a full act. Lord, when you come into our lives and transform us, it's not something that is undone. And yet, God, we in our own sinfulness, as Solomon did, can turn from you, can produce false idols in our lives, can even worship things, God, that we ought not to worship. And it might not look like it does in Solomon's times, but we certainly put things and stuff ahead of you. Maybe even other people in our lives that we put ahead of you, Lord. God, we want you not just to be Savior, but to be Lord of our lives. So, God, in these moments, I pray that we would commit that anew before you, that we would confess our sin, trusting that you are faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Lord, where there is sin, there's results to sin. And sometimes that is just a reality of this world. Sometimes that's brought about by the way that things work here. And sometimes that can be judgment from you. Lord, I believe that more often than not, you extend grace day after day after day. And yet it is within your right and power and is righteous for you to bring judgment upon us. And so God, if there is judgment on us in our lives, I pray that we would see that and we would understand that for what it is. And that we would truly turn from the sin that brought us to that place. God, we seek your forgiveness in these moments. And I pray, Lord, that those that are listening to this would turn their hearts towards you, would seek within their own lives through the lens of your Holy Spirit what is wrong, and would truly confess and repent before you. In your name we pray. Amen. Let us turn to God in worship once again.
Wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead seen in one, Father, Spirit, Son, Lion and the Lamb, Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. Name above all names, worthy of all praise. My heart will sing how great is our God.
Benediction today is found in 1 John chapter 1, verse 8. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Go in peace.